Good afternoon. We'd like to welcome you to this liturgy for Good Friday services, and we ask you at this time to please make sure your cell phones are turned off. We also ask you to please be generous with the Good Friday collection for the Holy Land, and I believe we want you to follow along on page 22 when we do the Passion. You are the crowd, letter C, so make sure we hear you out there, okay? Thank you.
Remember your mercies, O Lord, and with your eternal protection, sanctify your servants, for whom Christ your Son, by the shedding of his blood, established the paschal mystery, who lives and reigns forever and ever.
Amen.
Let's be seated.
A reading from the book of the prophet Isaiah. See, my servant shall prosper. He shall be raised high and greatly exalted. Even as many were amazed at him, so marred was his look beyond human semblance, and his appearance beyond that of the sons of man. So shall he startle many nations. Because of him, kings shall stand speechless, for those who have not been told shall see. Those who have not heard shall ponder it. Who would believe what we have heard? To whom has the arm of the Lord been revealed? He grew up like a sapling before him, like a shoot from the parched earth. There was in him no stately bearing to make us look at him, nor appearance that would attract us to him. He was spurned and avoided by people, a man of suffering, accustomed to infirmity, one of those from whom people hide their faces, spurned, and we held him in no esteem. Yet it was our infirmities that he bore, our sufferings that he endured. While we thought of him as stricken, as one smitten by God and afflicted, but he was pierced for our offenses, crushed for our sins. Upon him was the chastisement that makes us whole. By his stripes we were healed. We had all gone astray like sheep, each following his own way. But the Lord laid upon him the guilt of us all. Though he was harshly treated, he submitted and opened not his mouth, like a lamb led to the slaughter, or a sheep before the shearers. He was silent and opened not his mouth. Oppressed and condemned, he was taken away, and who would have thought any more of his destiny? He was cut off from the land of the living and smitten for the sin of his people. A grave was assigned for him by among the wicked, and a burial place with evildoers, though he had done no wrong nor spoken any falsehood. But the Lord was pleased to crush him in infirmity. If he gives his life as an offering for sin, he shall see his descendants in a long life, and the will of the Lord shall be accomplished through him. Because of his affliction, he shall see the light in fullness of days. Through his suffering, my servant shall justify many, and their guilt he shall bear. Therefore, I will give him his portion among the great, and he shall divide the spoils with the mighty. Because he surrendered himself to death and was counted among the wicked, he shall take away the sins of many and win pardon for their offenses. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Father, into your hands I commend my spirit. Father, into your hands I commend my spirit. In you, O Lord, I take refuge. Let me never be put to shame. In your justice, rescue me. Into your hands I commend my spirit. You will redeem me, O Lord, O faithful God. I am an object of reproach, a laughingstock to my neighbors and a dread to my friends. They who see me abroad flee from me. I am forgotten like the unremembered dead. I am like a dish that is broken. Father, into your hands I commend my spirit. But my trust is in you, O Lord. I say you are my God. In your hands is my destiny. Rescue me from the clutches of my enemies and my persecutors. Father, into your hands I commend my spirit. Let your face shine upon your servants. Save me in your kindness. Take courage and be stout-hearted, all you who hope in the Lord. Father, into your hands I commend my spirit.
A reading from the letter to the Hebrews. Brothers and sisters, since we have a great high priest who has passed through the heavens, Jesus, the Son of God, let us hold fast to our confession. For we do not have a high priest who is unable to sympathize with our weaknesses, but one who has similarly been tested in every way, yet without sin. So let us confidently approach the throne of grace to receive mercy and to find grace for timely help. In the days when Christ was in the flesh, he offered prayers and supplications with loud cries and tears to the one who was able to save him from death, and he was heard because of his reverence. Son though he was, he learned obedience from what he suffered. And when he was made perfect, he became the source of eternal salvation for all who obey him. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ, King of endless glory. Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ, King of endless glory. Christ became obedient to the point of death, even death on a cross. Because of this, God greatly exalted him and bestowed on him the name which is above every other name. Christ, King of endless glory.
I invite you now to join with us in the proclamation of the Passion, which is on page 25 in your missalettes, as you have your part to play in this proclamation of the Paschal Mystery.
The Passion of our Lord Jesus Christ according to John. Jesus went out with his disciples across the Kidron Valley to where there was a garden, into which he and his disciples entered. Judas, his betrayer, also knew the place, because Jesus had often met there with his disciples. So Judas got a band of soldiers and guards from the chief priests and the Pharisees and went there with lanterns, torches, and weapons. Jesus, knowing everything that was going to happen to him, went out and said to them,
"Whom are you looking for?"
They answered him,
"Jesus."
He said to them,
"I am."
Judas, his betrayer, was also with them, and when he said to them, "I am," they turned away and fell to the ground. So he asked again,
"Whom are you looking for?"
They said,
"Jesus."
Jesus answered,
"I told you that I am. So if you are looking for me, let these men go."
This was to fulfill what he had said, "I have not lost any of those you gave me." Then Simon Peter, who had a sword, drew it, struck the high priest's slave, and cut off his right ear. The slave's name was Malchus. Jesus said to Peter,
"Put your sword into its scabbard. Shall I not drink the cup that the Father gave me?"
So the band of soldiers, the tribune, and the Jewish guards seized Jesus, bound him, and brought him to Annas first. He was the father-in-law of Caiaphas, who was high priest that year. It was Caiaphas who had counseled the Jews that it was better that one man should die rather than the people. Simon Peter and another disciple followed Jesus. Now the other disciple was known to the high priest, and he entered the courtyard of the high priest with Jesus. But Peter stood at the gate outside. So the other disciple, the acquaintance of the high priest, went out and spoke to the gatekeeper and brought Peter in. Then the maid, who was the gatekeeper, said to Peter, he said,
"I am not."
Now the slaves and the guards were standing around a charcoal fire that they had made because it was cold and were warming themselves. Peter was also standing there keeping warm. The high priest questioned Jesus about his disciples and about his doctrine. Jesus answered him,
"I have spoken publicly to the world. I have always taught in a synagogue or in the temple area where all the Jews gather. And in secret I have said nothing. Why ask me? Ask those who heard me what I said to them. They know what I said."
When he had said this, one of the temple guards standing there struck Jesus and said,
"Is this the way you answer the high priest?"
Jesus answered him,
"If I have spoken wrongly, testify to the wrong. But if I have spoken rightly, why do you strike me?"
Then Annas sent him bound to Caiaphas the high priest. Now Simon Peter was standing there keeping warm, and they said to him, he denied it and said,
"I am not."
One of the slaves of the high priest, a relative of the one whose ear Peter had cut off, said, again, Peter denied it, and immediately the cock crowed. Then they brought Jesus from Caiaphas to the praetorium. It was morning, and they themselves did not enter the praetorium in order not to be defiled so that they could eat the Passover. So Pilate came out to them and said,
"What charge do you bring against this man?"
They answered and said to him, at this, Pilate said to them,
"Take him yourselves and judge him according to your law."
The Jews answered him, in order that the word of Jesus might be fulfilled, that he said, indicating the kind of death he would die. So Pilate went back into the praetorium and summoned Jesus and said to him,
"Are you the king of the Jews?"
Jesus answered,
"Do you say this on your own, or have others told you about me?"
Pilate answered,
"I am not a Jew, am I? Your own nation and the chief priests handed you over to me. What have you done?"
Jesus answered,
"My kingdom does not belong to this world. If my kingdom did belong to this world, my attendants would be fighting to keep me from being handed over to the Jews. But as it is, my kingdom is not here.
So Pilate said to him,
"Then you are a king?"
Jesus answered,
"You say I am a king. For this I was born, and for this I came into the world, to testify to the truth. Everyone who belongs to the truth listens to my voice."
Pilate said to him,
"What is truth?"
When he had said this, he again went out to the Jews and said to them,
"I find no guilt in him, but you have a custom that I release one prisoner to you at Passover. Do you want me to release to you the King of the Jews?"
They cried out again,
"Barabbas."
Now Barabbas was a revolutionary. Then Pilate took Jesus and had him scourged. And the soldiers wove a crown out of thorns and placed it on his head and clothed him in a purple cloak. And they came to him and said, and they struck him repeatedly. Once more, Pilate went out and said to them,
"Look, I am bringing him out to you so that you may know that I find no guilt in him."
So Jesus came out wearing the crown of thorns and the purple cloak, and Pilate said to them,
"Behold the man."
When the chief priests and the guards saw him, they cried out, Pilate said to them,
"Take him yourselves and crucify him. I find no guilt in him."
The Jews answered, Now when Pilate heard this statement, he became even more afraid and went back into the praetorium and said to Jesus,
"Where are you from?"
Jesus did not answer him, so Pilate said to him,
"Do you not speak to me? Do you not know that I have power to release you and I have power to crucify you?"
Jesus answered him,
"You would have no power over me if it had not been given to you from above. For this reason, the one who handed me over to you has the greater sin."
Consequently, Pilate tried to release him, but the Jews cried out, When Pilate heard these words, he brought Jesus out and seated him on the judge's bench in the place called Stone Pavement, in Hebrew, Gabbatha. It was preparation day for Passover, and it was about noon, and he said to the Jews,
"Behold your king."
They cried out, Pilate said to them,
"Shall I crucify your king?"
The chief priests answered,
"Then
he handed him over them. He handed over to them to be crucified. So they took Jesus, and carrying the cross himself, he went out to what is called the place of the skull, in Hebrew, Golgotha. There they crucified him, and with him two others, one on either side, with Jesus in the middle. Pilate also had an inscription written and put on the cross. It read, "Jesus, the Nazarene, the King of the Jews." Now many of the Jews read this inscription, because the place where Jesus was crucified was near the city. And it was written in Hebrew, Latin, and Greek. So the chief priests of the Jews said to Pilate, Pilate answered,
"What I have written, I have written."
When the soldiers had crucified Jesus, they took his clothes and divided them into four shares, a share for each soldier. They also took his tunic, but the tunic was seamless, woven in one piece from the top down. So they said to one another, "In order that the passage of Scripture might be fulfilled that says, 'They divided my garments among them, and for my vesture they cast lots.'" This is what the soldiers did. Standing by the cross of Jesus were his mother and his mother's sister Mary, the wife of Clopas, and Mary of Magdala. When Jesus saw his mother and the disciple there whom he loved, he said to his mother,
"Woman, behold your son."
Then he said to the disciple,
"Behold your mother."
And from that hour, the disciple took her into his home. After this, aware that everything was now finished, in order that the scripture might be fulfilled, Jesus said,
"I thirst."
There was a vessel filled with common wine, so they put a sponge soaked in wine on a sprig of hyssop and put it up to his mouth. When Jesus had taken the wine, he said,
"It is finished."
And bowing his head, he handed over the spirit. Now, since it was preparation day, in order that the bodies might not remain on the cross on the Sabbath, for the Sabbath day of that week was a solemn one, the Jews asked Pilate that their legs be broken and that they be taken down. So the soldiers came and broke the legs of the first and then of the other one who was crucified with Jesus. But when they came to Jesus and saw that he was already dead, they did not break his legs, but one soldier thrust his lance into his side, and immediately blood and water flowed out. An eyewitness had testified, and his testimony is true. He knows that he is speaking the truth, so that you also may come to believe. For this happened so that the scripture passage might be fulfilled. Not a bone of it will be broken. And again, another passage says, "They will look upon him whom they have pierced." After this, Joseph of Arimathea, secretly a disciple of Jesus for fear of the Jews, asked Pilate if he could remove the body of Jesus, and Pilate permitted it. So he came and took his body. Nicodemus, the one who had first come to him at night, also came bringing a mixture of myrrh and aloes, weighing about 100 pounds. They took the body of Jesus and bound it with burial cloths along with the spices, according to the Jewish burial custom. Now in the place where he had been crucified, there was a garden, and in the garden a new tomb in which no one had yet been buried. So they laid Jesus there because of the Jewish preparation day, for the tomb was close by. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. A warm welcome to all of you as we celebrate this day, the only day of the year when the church does not permit a mass to be celebrated, that the communion we will receive in a few moments has been consecrated at the Holy Thursday liturgy. This is the day when we come to hear the Passion read today, as we did on Palm Sunday, and to carry into our hearts the mystery of our Creator's boundless love for each and every one of us. We think of those who are with us today, physically, those who are with us on live stream, of course. And I often think of being a person who likes movies quite a bit. Those who know me know that I like film quite a lot. And I've always been very grateful for some of the most beautiful films. When you see Ben-Hur, how many have ever watched Ben-Hur? Right? It's a great film. And Moses becomes a Judah Ben-Hur, right? So it's kind of interesting for those who know. Godspell, how many have ever seen Godspell? It's great. How they portray the passion and the crucifixion of Jesus is quite remarkable. And then later, those who have seen Jesus Christ Superstar. How many have seen Jesus Christ Superstar? Quite something, isn't it? It's amazing. And then we see things like Jesus of Nazareth by Zeffirelli. We see all the wonderful things that film and new artistic renditions can give to us about the passion of Jesus. And I think sometimes that it's important for us to think about what this really is, what this mystery of faith truly is, in the Paschal mystery. Not to make us feel guilty, but to remind us of how we are wonderfully loved by an unbounded love by God in Jesus. From the very essential beginning of creation, John's Passion mentions the garden, of course, which is so interesting to me. And each one of us, we today, are made in the image and likeness of God's love. And the challenge, I think, of the Passion on Good Friday is always that Jesus says, my kingdom does not belong in this world. It is so interesting, and there's so many people still fighting to make the kingdom in this world. And we think of how important it is for us to be created, to share infinite love and friendship with God, who so loved the world that he gave his only son, so that everyone who believes in him may not be lost, but may have eternal life. Not too long ago, I was able to watch a film about Mr. Rogers. How many of you have ever seen Mr. Rogers on TV, right? It was a great film with Tom Hanks, who used to be a great resident of Cleveland many years ago, and when he started his career as an actor. And he plays Fred Rogers in the film about Mr. Rogers' Neighborhood. And it's wonderful because Fred Rogers was truly a wonderfully Christian man who tried to bring a light into dark places. And it's a fairly true story about someone who was terribly lost in his life, who had been hurt by people who had sought to do their own thing, to be selfish. And it truly was a very an amazing story about this man, very talented man, who came to do an interview for a famous magazine about Fred Rogers. And Fred Rogers, Mr. Rogers, helps him to open up to a whole new understanding of what love is truly like, that we have been created to share infinite love and friendship with God. And so the cross, as repellent as it is as a invention of execution and pain by the Romans, who sought to bring everything into their kingdom, becomes truly a sign of love. It is interesting that those who are great writers, T.S. Eliot wrote that the cross stands as the still point of the turning world. And if we want to understand what the cross is, what the Passion of Jesus is, it is the very center point of the turning world. A world that needs to hear that again and again from each and every one of us. That the cross is the greatest good. Goodness itself, God's only begotten Son, accepted to endure the cross as a consequence of becoming human, so as to prove his love for us, not his condemnation. And the greatest evil done was done to him. Jesus' fate resulted in his being fully human in a violent, inhumane world, a world that we created, a world that human beings created. And yet God took upon himself all the hatred of the world. What happened to him was the most dramatic manifestation of what we have made. But on the cross, he bore all of our faults. He shouldered all of our sins in himself. His death absorbed the worst evil that we have or will ever do. It's an amazing statement that God took upon himself all of our sins. And so the cross reassures us that God's will, as only God can, brings unimaginable goodness out of the pain and anguish of the world. These days, so many people say that they are disheartened by what they see around them. And we have to be reminded on this Good Friday and this Easter that God brought unimaginable good out of the anguish of the world, that there is still great hope for us. And so as Holy Week has unfolded, we are not just spectators, we are participants in that passion of Jesus. We are among those on Palm Sunday who were there to say Hosanna, and later would say crucify him. We are present with other disciples in the upper room celebrating the Passover on Holy Thursday. We are sorrowing witnesses on Calvary alongside Mary, his mother, mentioned in the gospel today. And today we silently share the same grief and sense of loss that they felt on that day before the resurrection took place. And on Easter, we are with Mary Magdalene, who was in the garden, a renewed garden, not the Eden of old, but the new garden of the resurrection, where the lifeless body of Jesus had once lain, and she recognizes him in a whole new way when he speaks her name. Jesus speaks our name as well. So the resurrection that we will celebrate, that makes it possible to understand God's unimaginable love for us, is the final meaning of the crucifixion. If we have died with him, then we shall also rise with him. How important that is. There is no resurrection without the crucifixion. And so we, each of us in our own way, go through the terrible losses and evils that abound in the world, but we never give up hope because of the unimaginable love of God brought to us in Jesus. This is the third crucifix that has graced St. Angelo Merici Church. The first one, back 100 years ago or so, is in the sacristy. The second one is in the school. And this is the third one. And it's a beautiful, wonderful, artistic rendition from a great artist who wants us to know about the joy of the resurrection that is made possible by the crucifixion. And so the cross becomes our ladder to God's grace. And so as we come in to celebrate in this church, we ask God to help remind us of that. If we have died with him, then we will also rise with him. Let's stand together. Today we have special prayers of intercession that the church wants us to use to remind us of the importance of prayer as we bring God's kingdom to fruition in the world today. And so let us pray together. Our intercessions begin on page 29. Let us pray, dearly beloved, for the Holy Church of God, that our God and Lord be pleased to give her peace, to guard her, and to unite her throughout the whole world, and grant that leading our life in tranquility and quiet, we may glorify God, the Almighty Father. Almighty ever-living God, who in Christ revealed your glory to all the nations, watch over the works of your mercy, that your church, spread throughout the whole world, may persevere with steadfast faith in confessing your name, through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Let us pray also for our most holy Father, Pope Francis, that our Lord God, who chose him for the order of bishops, may keep him safe and unharmed for the Lord's holy church to govern the holy people of God. Almighty ever-living God, by whose decree all things are founded, look with favor on our prayers, and in your kindness protect the Pope chosen for us, that under him the Christian people governed by you, their maker, may grow in merit by reason of their faith, through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Let us pray for our Bishop Edward, for all bishops, priests, and deacons of the church, and for the whole of the faithful people. Almighty ever-living God, by whose Spirit the whole body of the church is sanctified and governed, hear our humble prayer for your ministers, that by the gift of your grace all may serve you faithfully through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Let us also pray for our catechumens and throughout the whole world, that our Lord God may open wide the ears of their inmost hearts and unlock the gates of his mercy, that having received forgiveness for all their sins through the waters of rebirth, they too might be one with Christ Jesus our Lord. Almighty ever-living God, who made your church ever fruitful with new offspring, increase the faith and understanding of our catechumens, that reborn in the font of baptism, they may be added to the number of your adopted children through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Let us also pray for all of our sisters and brothers who believe in Christ, that our God and Lord may be pleased as they live the truth to gather them together and keep them in his one church. Almighty ever-living God, who gather what is scattered and keep together what you have gathered, look kindly on the flock of your Son, that those whom one baptism has consecrated may be joined together by integrity of faith and united in the bond of charity through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Let us also pray for the Jewish people to whom the Lord God spoke first, that he may grant them to advance in love of his name and in faithfulness to his covenant. Almighty ever-living God, who bestowed your promises on Abraham and his descendants, graciously hear the prayers of your church, that the people you first made your own may attain the fullness of redemption through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Let us also pray for those who do not believe in Christ, that enlightened by the Holy Spirit, they too may enter on the way of salvation. Almighty ever-living God, grant to those who do not confess Christ that by walking before you with a sincere heart they may find the truth, and that we ourselves, being constant in mutual love and striving to understand more fully the mystery of your life, may be made more perfect witnesses to your love in the world through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Let us pray for those who do not acknowledge God, that following what is right in sincerity of heart, they may find the way to God himself. Almighty ever-living God, who created all people to seek you always by desiring you, and by finding you, come to rest. Grant, we pray, that despite every harmful obstacle, all may recognize the signs of your fatherly love and witness of the good works done by those who believe in you, and so in gladness confess you, the one true God and Father of our human race, through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Let us pray for those in public office, that our God and Lord may direct their minds and hearts according to his will for the true peace and freedom of all. Almighty ever-living God, in whose hand lies every human heart and the rights of peoples, Look with favor, we pray, on those who govern with authority over us, that throughout the whole world, the prosperity of peoples, the assurance of peace, and freedom of religion may through your gift be made secure through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Let us pray, dearly beloved, to God, the Almighty Father, that he may cleanse the world of all errors, banish disease, drive out hunger, unlock prisons, loosen fetters, granting to travelers safety, to pilgrims return, health to the sick, salvation to the dying. Almighty ever-living God, comfort the mourners, strengthen all those who toil. May the prayers of those who cry out in any tribulation come before you, that all may rejoice because of, in their hour of need, that your mercy was at hand through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Our bishop has given us one last prayer today to add to these intercessions at this time in the history of our faith. Let us pray for those in war-torn lands, that our God and Lord may bring peace to the world and an end to the conflicts in Ukraine, Russia, Israel, Gaza, and elsewhere, by moving hearts to reconciliation and inspiring actions which promote healing and hope. Almighty ever-living God, who fashioned the dignity of every human person, hear the cries of those whose lives have been shattered by violence and the atrocities of war. Redeem the suffering of your people in war-torn lands and arouse us to abandon the ways of death for the blessings of life, so that all governments, nations, and peoples may learn to live in peace through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Let's be seated now. On Good Friday, the Holy Father, the Church throughout the world, takes up a special collection for the shrines of the Holy Land, and so we will do that at this time.
Please join in singing number 154, O Sacred Head Surrounded, number 154.
O Sacred Head surrounded by crown of piercing thorn, O bleeding head so wounded, reviled and put to scorn, the power of death comes o'er you, the glow of life decays. Yet angel hosts adore you and tremble as they gaze. In this your bitter passion, God Shepherd, think of me. With your most kind compassion, unworthy though I be, beneath your cross abiding, forever would I rest. In your dear love confiding, and with your presence blessed, what language
As we come to the adoration of the cross, let us stand together. Behold the wood of the cross, on which hung the salvation of the world. Come, let us adore. Behold the wood of the cross, on which hung the salvation of the world. Come, let us adore. Behold the wood of the cross, on which hung the salvation of the world. Come, let us adore.
Upon the ground and die,
it shall remain but a single grain, and not give life. Behold, behold, the wood of the cross, on which is hung our salvation. O come, let us adore. And when my hour of glory comes, as all was meant to be, you shall see me lifted up upon a tree. Behold, behold, the wood of the cross, on which is hung our salvation. O come, let us adore. For there can be no greater love shown upon this land than in the one who came to die, that we might live. Behold, behold, the wood of the cross, on which is hung our salvation. O come, let us adore. My Father, if it be your plan, this cup might pass me by, yet let it happen as you will. If I must die, behold, behold, the wood of the cross, on which is hung our salvation.
At the Savior's command, informed by divine teaching, we dare to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days. By the help of your mercy, we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ.
For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever.
May the receiving of your body and blood, Lord Jesus Christ, not bring us condemnation or judgment, but through your loving mercy, be for us protection in mind and body and a healing remedy. Behold the Lamb of God. Behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb. Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof, but only say the word and my soul shall be healed.
Please join in singing number 485, What Wondrous Love Is This? Number 485.
Thank you.
from death I'm free, I'll sing on, I'll sing on. And when from death I'm free, I'll sing on. And when from death I'm free, I'll sing and joyful be. And through eternity, I'll sing on, I'll sing on. And through eternity, I'll sing on. What wondrous love is this, O my soul, O my soul? What wondrous love is this, O my soul? What wondrous love is this that caused the Lord of bliss to bear the dreadful curse for my soul, for my soul? To bear the dreadful curse for my soul.
Let us offer a prayer today, page 209 in the Missalette. One of the greatest of all the saints who truly understood the cross of Christ and received the wounds of Christ towards the end of his life was Saint Francis of Assisi. As we pray for peace and pray for our world, let us offer this prayer together. Lord, make me an instrument of your peace. Where there is hatred, let me sow love. Where there is injury, pardon. Where there is doubt, faith. Where there is despair, hope. Where there is darkness, light. Where there is sadness, joy. O Divine Master, grant that I may not so much seek to be consoled as to console, to be understood as to understand, to be loved as to love. For it is in giving that we receive, it is in pardoning that we are pardoned, and it is in dying that we are born to eternal life. Amen. Let us stand together. We thank everyone for being here today and those who are with us on live stream. We thank Danny and Mike and our violinist, all the ministers today, lectors and altar servers, and our young retired deacon, Deacon Jim, today is with us, who is 94 years young, right? Oy vey, right? And still working at his residence. That's quite nice. Tomorrow is a food blessing at 12 o'clock, when the church will smell of garlic and sausage, etc. tomorrow. And confessions at 1 to 2 until they're all heard. Then tomorrow the vigil is at 8:30. Of course, there is no 4:30 mass on the vigil. And check out the websites for all that. Thank you all today for coming. Let us pray. Almighty, ever-living God, who have restored us to life by the blessed death and resurrection of your Christ, preserve in us the work of your mercy, that by partaking of this mystery, we may have a life unceasingly devoted to you, through Christ our Lord. Let's bow our heads for the blessing. May abundant blessing, O Lord, we pray, descend upon us, your people, who have honored the death of your Son in the hope of our resurrection. May pardon come, comfort be given, holy faith increase, and everlasting redemption be made secure, through Christ our Lord.